My name is Wayne Lewis from Atlantic Starr, and I'm here at the Kre8tive Lounge.
What's going on, family? It's your boy Pop, and welcome to the Clarity Lounge right here at the Kre8tive Lounge. Yep, that's right, in our beautiful state-of-the-art full production studio. We're just taking things to a whole nother level. This is what we do, and today I have an extremely special show with an extremely special guest, someone who has literally known me before I was me, right? So what I want to do is I want to transition right into this because I have the one, the only, Wayne Lewis of Atlantic Starr, okay? The hit maker, the super producer himself. And we're going to be digging into his story, where he came from, how did he know that music was his calling, and we're going to talk about the inspiration behind that pen that has taken the world by storm. All right? So if y'all ready, tap in. Let's go.
Love when it's right, it's all so good. But when it ain't good, when it goes bad, baby. Y'all better help me with this one. Don't make me waste my time up here. Y'all ready? Come on, sing it with me now. I don't know what to say.
Uncle Wayne, what's going on, man?
What's up, man?
Yes, indeed.
My nizzle.
Yes, indeed. We here.
We here.
Listen, first and foremost, this is a surreal moment because growing up, right, me, Booby Lou, Brandon, like, we always knew that our uncles were a big deal, right? Because of the response that we would get, and people would talk about y'all all the time. We would hear the songs come on the radio. My mother was telling me how every time, if your heart wasn't in it, mm-hmm. every time that video comes on, and you and Uncle David have a little tussle, I would cry and say, don't fight, right?
Yeah.
So growing up, kind of when you guys were really, really rolling, we knew that you were a big deal, but we didn't know the extent of it, right?
Right.
We didn't know the extent of it, so it's so incredible that all of these years later, now that we're grown, and we look back and we're like, man, like, you all, like, were or are classic, and you all are most certainly a staple in music, period, right? And what you guys were able to accomplish was absolutely amazing. So what I want to do is I want to back up a little bit, right? Native born, 914, Greenburgh, stand up,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You got you at what point did you realize that music was something that was a gift for you?
Well, I could tell you the very first story that I tell in interviews, the very first thing that happened to me was I was, I'm going to date myself now. I was listening to, my father had a transistor radio on top of the refrigerator. When we were kids, we called it the icebox.
Okay.
Let me stop dating myself. But this is all the music that we had at the time, because he wasn't too big into all technology and everything, and we didn't have the whole stereo thing, but we just had a transistor radio. And I found myself dissecting the parts. Most people just listen to the record and they know they either like it or they don't. But somehow my brain started separating each instrument. This is the bass part, this is the guitar, this is the piano part, this is the... Then I would hear the orchestra playing stuff through there. I would notice that something's going on other than the bass and the...
Yeah.
And I didn't realize I was on my way to becoming a record producer,
an
arranger. That's how it starts off, when you can start separating parts and separating notes. I knew that I was hearing more than one note, which we call the melody now, but I didn't know I was hearing other notes harmonizing with those notes, alto, tenor, baritone, you know, with the soprano. But I was hearing all this stuff when I was a little kid. I just didn't know what it was. But I was separating all of the parts, and so I knew that was my calling. But I didn't know that I was going to be where I was going to be later. But I felt it. The spirit, everything just hit me, and that's all I wanted to do. And then one day my mother took me to a friend of hers' church, and I saw this lady playing the piano, and all those notes that was coming out of that box, I didn't even know. This was the first time I had really been up and close with on a piano.
Yeah.
And I was just mesmerized. I stood there watching it, hitting the ivories, and all those notes, musical notes that was coming. I was like, that's what I want to do. And I told my mother from that point on, I want to play that thing that lady was playing in the church. And the rest was history.
Wow. Okay. So naturally, so you're hearing these things, you're starting to dissect the music, and you didn't even realize what you were doing at that point. So now you identify that, okay, she's playing this piano, now I want to do that.
Right.
At what point did you realize that you could sing as well?
My brother David and I used to sit in the window of the old house that we grew up in, and it used to be alcoholics. We called them, what do we call them back in the day? Winos or whatever we used to call them back in the day.
Yeah.
And, you know, of course, we were poor, living in that poor area, so they would come through our yard from another house and walk through our yard to get to another street.
Wow.
Which you shouldn't do, walking through somebody else's property.
Yeah.
But so many people had done it for so many years that they made a path. And so we used to just sing for people. And people used to stop and go, listen to them, look at them little cat-eye boys.
Wow.
Singing.
Cat-eye boys.
Them light-eye boys singing, little kids. And David had a soprano, male soprano voice. I had a alto voice, but we didn't know. But he would sing melody, and I would sing harmony to it, not knowing what we was doing, but it naturally, we just naturally harmonized.
Wow.
And then, so my mother, somebody heard us and told us we got to sing in church.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to them boys singing. So they had us singing in church one day, and we sang a song called Whisper a Prayer. And he sang soprano, and I sang alto. And no music, just a cappella.
Oh, wow.
And then when we were done, we were at the last part. So keep your heart in tune.
Come on.
And when we sang that last note, we was about to walk away, and the whole church is on their feet screaming.
Wow.
But it scared me and my brother to death, me and David to death.
Yeah.
We were petrified.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't let us sit down. They all pushed us back. No, more.
Wow.
We were so scared at the reaction, we didn't know what to do. And they told my mother to stand up, Sister Louis, stand. Yeah. And she was so petrified from the reaction that she couldn't even stand on her feet. Her legs was like wobbly.
Wow.
She couldn't even. But that was our first taste of audience applause or audience appreciation.
Yeah.
But we had no idea, not that. We were just used to singing in the window when drunkards would walk by.
Wow.
And
wow.
From that point on, people started making us do stuff, and then it went from there.
Went from there. So this is, so you all are young, so now you guys are early adolescent.
Mm-hmm.
So now you get into your teenage years. Now, are you continuing to sing, or like how did things start to transition? Were you starting to sing and starting to play the instrument as well and blending the two? Like how did the gift started to transition as you got older?
Well, when I got into sixth grade, between sixth and seventh grade, my voice dropped.
Mm.
And I lost control of it.
Wow.
It was turning into an adult voice, but it didn't have anywhere to land because I was still adolescent.
Wow.
But David's voice stayed high. So I couldn't control my voice. My notes was just everywhere. So he continued on for a while without me. Surprising, I still love him after
all. Yeah.
And a man named Mr. Hodson, Brother Hodson from the church, who played guitar with a group from Bermuda called the Bermuda Boys, and they harmonized and they were crooners. Wonderful. That music was so wonderful at the time. But anyway, he was one of the first guitar players I saw. But then he started to work with David, and when I tried to sing, he couldn't really work with me because my voice was all over the place.
Yeah.
So David went on a while to work with him for a while. And that's, I think, around the time he did Ted Mack's Amateur Hour.
Okay.
And won, and started getting known and started, but what I remember when I was in school, they had a concert, I think, at the school, and jealousy came over me. And this is how I know the two spirits are there.
Yeah.
The evil spirit and the Holy Spirit, because the evil spirit instantly came over me to make me feel jealous. But the Holy Spirit came over me and said, just pray about it. Mm-hmm. When I was just a little kid,
yeah.
Well, we wasn't as little as when we first started off, but I was very young. And so I prayed and asked God to take the jealousy away from me. And before I could even finish praying, no more jealousy. Wow. I sat up there and watched them perform.
Yeah.
Loved it, clapped. It's so amazing hugging them, how great it was.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's why nobody can't tell me that the Holy Spirit and the evil spirit both are not very well alive and well.
Pronounced, yep.
And
yep.
Then when we went on from there, my piano teacher saw him on Ted Mack, and she asked, did he want to take piano lessons?
Okay.
And he started with her. And a year later, she asked, was there anybody else in the house? Met us, and so it was a whole bunch of us.
Yeah.
And she wanted to know if there was somebody else who wanted to take piano lessons. And I was,
Yeah.
Because I remember from the day I told you I saw the lady playing, that's all I wanted to do. And God was testing me then because he was getting all the opportunities.
Mm.
But then I was just following him, loving what he was doing, and then God opened up a way for me. He told her to say, is there anybody else in that house?
Yeah, who wants to,
and wow. And there I was and took advantage of it and took piano for about 11 years. And then because we studied with her, we studied classical music.
Okay.
So what that did was taught David and I, because we grew up, our roots is R&B and gospel.
Yeah.
But from that radio, we listened to the Beatles. We listened to all the Motown. We listened to everything. So. Country, Western, everything. So by the time we started going off on our own, we had a background that was for every genre.
Yeah.
So we could arrange the classical music and everything on top of our R&B music ourselves.
Wow.
Because we studied classical.
Jeez.
Yeah.
So now you guys are literally building your tool chest, if you will, of musical instruments, of arranging, and so you're kind of starting to find yourself. So you said that once your voice dropped, it was difficult for you to be able to control it. So at what point in time were you able to kind of get the reins, if you will, or get control back over your voice now with the lower, you know, now that your voice was lower?
In high school.
Okay.
It started coming back, and then we formed a group called Unchained Youth.
Oh, okay.
And that's where our songwriting started. That's where we started really getting our skills together, not only taking classical piano, but how to work your instrument pop style, where you put the right chords together. And then I started becoming a lyricist, basically like in sixth grade, and then went to seventh grade Webb School in Hartsdale, and then on to Woodlands for the high school years. By the time I got into Woodlands, I was already writing lyrics. Mm. But I had to get a thesaurus and look at other poetry and then learn how songwriters actually in the music business wrote songs and develop learning the A section, the B section, the bridge, the choruses, what they were. And then I took everything that I had learned and started writing pop style, and then that's how we started making hit record formulas.
So hold on. See, stuff like that fascinates me because we're talking before YouTube, we're talking before internet, we're
right.
talking about before any of that stuff. So you literally how did you learn? Like, where did you go to? Was it the library? Like, where did you go to start to get these resources to start to learn how to you know, studying poetry how did you go about the process of learning how to do that so you can start to write? And also, what inspired you to even start writing?
Well, what inspired me is I had a lot on my mind.
Mm.
And I had I was very adventurous. I was always a loner who could sit there without nobody being around me and just be in my own world.
Mm.
Very creative and always just had a crazy wild imagination.
Yeah.
That's when I read that book, Where the Wild Things Are, I was like, oh, that's me. Opened up my house and turned into a whole forest, sitting there by myself, because we didn't have money and things to do, so we had to develop our own little, go into our own world.
Imagination, yeah.
And then as I, I used everything that I saw, I used to download it.
Mm.
It could be people talking, it could be the way people are moving, it could be how people are dressing. It could be foreign languages, people speaking with accents. I'm picking everything up around me, I'm picking up, and I used to wonder about everything. How do you do that? Why do you talk like that? What is that? What is the, you know, birds, bees? I walk through a forest and want to stay there all day. So fascinated about everything going on in the forest.
Wow.
So I had so much on my mind to write about, and I used to just write it down like poetry. But then I found out that if you're going to write a song, it can't just be loose like poetry. It has to have a structure. And that's when I started learning from the Beatles and people who wrote for the Jackson 5 and people who wrote, even James Brown.
Yeah.
He wasn't saying a lot, but he had his sections.
Yeah.
You know,
that's right.
A, B, C, and the chorus and the bridge and take it to the bridge. You know, what's the bridge? Oh, that section, that part. Okay, and what's the chorus? Oh, the chorus is the sing-along that you keep coming back to every time you go to the verses, you know.
You started putting the pieces together.
Right.
You started putting the pieces of the puzzle together. So this is high school. You start putting the pieces of the puzzle together.
Yeah.
So you all formed Unchained Youth in high school, Woodlands, shout out to Woodlands, and you started to write for your group.
Right.
Okay, so now are you guys performing at talent shows? How did you guys start to kind of get your names out there?
Talent shows, Battle of the Band, somebody's wedding if they paid us.
Okay, yeah.
Wherever we could play, and because it was just honing our skills.
Yeah.
And then we would rehearse a lot.
Okay.
People's basements. mostly in the drummer's basement, but then we'd go, sometimes other parents would let us come into their house.
Yeah.
So we'd lug our equipment and, you know, we were into all of the, what's the latest equipment that came out, what kind of keyboards are out now, and what kind of, and it's crazy because that was our whole life. Now everything is,
yeah,
you know, just push a button on the computer. And musicians don't even get a chance to fall in love with different keyboards and, and different instruments, and which is a way of life.
Yeah.
You know, your instrument was your baby. Now, things are kind of sterile. You don't get a chance to live the music.
Yeah.
It's sampling what somebody else did, throwing an 808 kick on it. And then nobody's studying lyrics either. Nobody has anything real to say. Everybody's trying to make sure that they kind of not be different than anybody else. Everybody's kind of saying the same thing.
I'm glad you said that. One of the things that I value about your era and even my era of music, it was that being different, being unique, having your own style and presence was paramount. To sound like somebody else, or for someone to even say that you sounded like somebody else was offensive.
It was offensive, yeah.
Right? And so you now coming from that era and now seeing kind of where music is now, where do you think the collapse happened? You know what I mean? Like what do you think happened between you, where like you, because you all, like you said, were musicians, right? And even right. Still, you all are musicians, right? You guys, you all understand the actual music, students of the actual music. And now this is now not saying that there's no one like that now, but you've been around music long enough to have seen the progression or to have seen the transition, I should say.
Right.
How would you kind of, what do you think, or why do you think music now is different than it was back then?
Well, first of all, and I don't want to be negative, I'm only trying to track back to see what would happen. And I think a lot of it is like, it started to go to the streets and people started really expressing what's going on in the streets. And that was it. There was no need to study music or take, you know, travel anywhere, go, you know, to see what Beethoven did over here, to see what country western artists did over there, to see what's going on with the gospel roots, to see, everything was about the streets.
Yeah.
And then that became a young fad and it stayed because of money.
Mm.
And the record companies were saying, well, if this is where all this money is coming in like this, we don't want to put money into nothing else, talent, music talent, whatever. We want to keep it all right here.
Yeah.
So it kind of stayed there. And because nobody was really traveling outside the hood, the only thing they could talk about is the hood. And the only thing that was going on in the hood is, you know,
what they talked about. Yeah, yeah.
Then making babies and the whole thing, so that's what they talked about.
Yeah.
And then in the time when nobody was getting married no more, you know, no more families, no more anything organic.
Yeah, yeah.
And then technology came in and topped it all off. Now, I remember talking to young people about, you know, playing instruments and the whole stuff, and they used to look at me like, why are you doing all of that when you could just go to the computer and press a button and a beat will come down for you?
Yeah, yeah.
You know how, why are you playing the bass and the drums and all that stuff? And I've even seen youngsters not even know what the name of instruments are. Like if you show them a sax and you go, what is this? I don't know what that is or whatever, but they're calling themselves musicians.
Music. Yeah.
But they don't know nothing about music. So, you know, my friend who had a record deal around the same time I did at Capitol Records was telling me he went to NBC to do a segment or commercial or something he was doing there. And I think they were like on the third floor or something. And these kids went in there and they saw this drum set set up in the room for a session. And this kid called the other kid back and said, yo, 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 come here, look at these joints, man. Look at them joints. Them are some like some dinosaur joints set up right there. You mean people that's playing them S's, S-H-I-T's? Like, yeah, it's like, they couldn't understand it.
Yeah.
And they didn't even know what to call it, the drums. They just said, them joints, that's what they make beats, they used to make beats on.
Wow, man. See, that's, I'm not gonna unload on that, but I just interested from a musician's perspective. So now, let's
go. I want to clarify, yeah. I'm sorry. I don't want to come here and say that there's not a great story to tell from the hood.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that.
Yeah.
Because there's been some very interesting, creative, great projects that came from the hood.
Yeah.
We came from the hood. But I'm saying what happened was it kind of put a damper, it kind of smashed people down from growing and going to other places in the world and checking out how the other half lives and learning music and learning instruments, and technology came in and put the icing on the cake. Mm. So now none of the kids in the hood needed to go out and study any music, and especially anything that had anything to do with anything that wasn't hood.
Got you. Yeah, got you.
You see?
Got you.
And
yeah.
So, but then, that was by design, but that's another movie.
Yeah, that's another movie. But I'm glad you mentioned story. We're gonna come back to storytelling because I want to touch on that too. So now you're in talent shows. You're writing music in high school. You guys are rehearsing. You guys are making a name for yourself. Now, tell me what then happened, because now you guys have your group. You're writing. You're in your writing bag, you're in your, you know, your musician bag, right? Got control over your voice now. I'm sure that you all were starting to get some buzz locally anyway, you know, as you were doing these talent shows and open mics and things along those lines. So when did you decide that you guys were gonna take this on the road?
Well, we knew at some point that we were ready. So we went in the studio. And I think I was 13 when I first went in the studio. So we started making a lot of demos all through high school. And then my brother Jonathan was in a group called New Band. And some of the members from another group up the hill in Greenburgh. We call it Up the Hill because they were from houses and we were from the projects. But they were called, what were they called? I can't even think of the name of their group right now. They'll kill me if they knew. I couldn't even say the name of their group. But anyway, Sharon Bryant came to me again, another group in Greenburgh, and me and David came from Unchained Youth, and then we joined up with my brother's band, New Band, that had Porter Carroll, became Atlantic Stars drummer, and Clifford Archer, that became Atlantic Stars bass player. Duke Jones became Atlantic Stars trumpet, and Joey Phillips became Atlantic Stars percussionist. Sharon Bryant from, the name almost came to me again, became the lead vocalist from that group for Atlantic Star, and me and David became the musicians, but we became the songwriters too for Atlantic Star. And we became, after Bobby Eli did our first couple of records, and then James Carmichael started off us on our big career with all the big hit records, and then me and David took over for the two biggest songs of our career, which were Secret Lovers and Always.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but we started making records from high school, and then from that point on, we kept trying to get a deal. And then we all took that caravan out to the West Coast and got a, went and sat in the A&M Records, and Herb Alpert himself came to hear our audition, and we didn't leave there without a deal. He was like, stay where you are. Went to the back and talked and said, y'all got a deal.
Wow. So y'all packed up. So how old were you when y'all went to L.A.?
I turned 17 in L.A.
Wow. So you got a deal. You got a record deal at 17.
No, we stayed there and played gigs.
Okay, okay.
For about 3 years.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, 3-4 years before we actually got a deal. Yeah.
So you all decided y'all was just going to go out to L.A. And y'all were out in L.A. just gigging it out,
mm-hmm.
any place that you can go to go and play.
Right.
Wow, okay.
We was doing before hours, after hours, packing up, didn't have any roadies, we was doing it ourselves.
Yeah.
Pack up, go to the next club, set up, break it down again sometimes, and go to an after hours
club. Wow. That's dedication, man.
That's because we lived in Westwood, so we had to pay that high rent, so we was playing 3 gigs. But it was making us good.
Yeah.
And it was keeping us in shape.
Wow. Wow. See, okay, so y'all were everything. So y'all was playing, y'all was breaking down, y'all was setting up. Y'all was a big time. But y'all was paying your dues. So now you get discovered. So how did you all get discovered? How did you even end up in you said where was it that you guys got a record deal with originally?
Our manager was taking out after we was playing so many gigs everywhere like that. We were getting so good that we started making demos that sound like the finished product.
Oh.
And so then finally, after looking at all of the record companies, our manager went to A&M.
A&M, okay.
And let them hear it and then set up an audition. And then when we played live, Herb Alpert realized this ain't just some regular group.
Yeah.
They self-contained, these musicians, they don't have to hire nobody to play. They're their own songwriters and they're their own vocal performance. So he said, this is like a gold mine. It's like, this is a treasure. So they didn't want nobody else to get us, so they just signed us.
Snatched y'all up right away.
Yeah.
How did you feel? So you were up 20, 21?
Something like 21, 22, 23, I don't know, something.
So after you guys doing everything that y'all were doing, hustling like the way that you were hustling, to finally get a record deal, how did that feel when y'all got that deal?
Oh man, it felt... it was surreal. It was like a dream.
Mm.
But it wasn't until we started performing live after making a record that that was the real fantasy and dream come true. I remember being at the Rose Bowl. I think it was the Rose Bowl in LA, Hollywood Bowl.
Okay.
I said the Rose Bowl, Hollywood Bowl. And all those thousands of people out there. And I forgot what song we were doing, but I know I wrote it, sitting at home. And they started lighting up lighters, and it looked like lightning bugs, all over thousands of lightning bugs.
Wow.
And I tried to sing, and next thing I know, boom, boom. And I just started crying, I think.
Wow.
Because it overwhelmed me. And I was like, I wrote that song in my house sitting on my chair or something, and thousands of people are singing it.
Wow. That's crazy.
I almost couldn't get it together, but then my acting coaching skills kicked back in, and I fought through the emotions and then went back into my... But at first, I was so overwhelmed.
Wow.
I was so overwhelmed, I just could not believe it.
Were y'all nervous going out when y'all first went out on stage? Were y'all nervous? Like, what was going on behind the scenes behind the curtain?
Well, I wasn't so nervous because having a lot of experience playing before people.
Yeah.
In semi-large crowds, when you're in, you know, the big talent shows, and you, you know, you're on your way. You know what it feels like for people to be feeling you and love you. Right.
Yeah.
But this is the first time you have a finished professional project that went all around the world.
Yeah.
Everywhere you go, people know you're something that you personally wrote.
Yeah.
And they're singing it.
Yeah.
First, you were just singing it. No, let me change that word. It was your personal thing.
Yeah.
Now everybody's singing your personal thing. That you
like everybody peered it in your diary and they read it
right,
word for
right.
Wow.
So it was wow. really overwhelming experience. And it took me a while to get used to that. People showing us so much love.
Yeah.
And to this day, they always tell us our songs are timeless, like they just came out yesterday.
No, that's a fact. That's a fact. That's a fact. You talked about formula. You found the hit formula. And you, Uncle David, I know Uncle Johnny on a few, like you all were able to not just write a hit, but write many hits. And you talked about storytelling, and I wanted to put, that's why I wanted to put a pin in it, because one of the things that I think is remarkable about you is your ability to tell stories. And the way that you're able to, the way that you tell the story it really literally takes the listener along the journey that I think is what's so captivating. When did you, or how, as you're writing, do you already kind of have the story in your head and you're just kind of plugging it into the formula? Like, what is your writing, like when you're writing, what is kind of your vibe? How do you do it? How do you get into your space?
That, you know, that's a good question, because most times, David and I would write together. Most of the hits we wrote together. So usually when we wrote together, he would give me a cassette.
A cassette.
With a bunch, here I'm dating myself again.
Yeah.
He would give me a cassette and would have the chords on it. Dun, 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 and then he would put a bass line, doom, do do doom, doom, or whatever on it. And then the guitar. So whatever the tempo was and whatever the instrumentation gave me a vibe of, that's where my brain would go to. It would take me somewhere. If it was a cool groove or something, it might take me to the streets of New York, driving with your girl or something, and what would you talk about? You know, the music would put me in a mood and would start putting stories in my head. And I would write according to the vibe of the music. Now, sometimes I would write lyrics first because something is on my mind. And then I would put those lyrics to music.
Got you. I love it. So you were inspired by the instrumentation or whatever happened to be on. So like,
or the beat, the tempo, the music, the instrumentation. What instruments he used to create, maybe some synthesizer or something. Might put me off into something natural.
Oh, man.
I might start thinking about, you know, it depends. You know.
I love that. So let's pull one out. So always. What was the inspiration behind Always, and how did that writing session happen?
Well, David started to write some chords, and they were so noble and so sincere, the formula. And then he used a grand, I think, was on the demo, and a rose, but the way the structure was almost like hymns.
Oh, wow.
And then I think Jonathan was with him one day and he heard it, and then he put like B section on it.
Okay.
The dum 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 dum, and then we come back to David section. Dum 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 dum. And yeah. So then I came in and heard that, and it sounds so solemn to me that a wedding song just came to my mind. Mm. What I would say to the person that I loved, the purest thing that God would tell me to say.
Wow.
And so God was basically giving me the lyrics. They was being downloaded. And when the song was done, I was sitting home one day and I said, I wrote that.
Wow.
I didn't even realize. I was like, but that's not me. That's not like, I have to give that credit to God.
Yeah.
When did I get good enough to write something like this?
Yeah.
And many times I've sat down and just looked at those lyrics and go, I wrote that.
Wow. And to this day, that thing is still one of the most played wedding songs ever. Like, that is that's amazing. I love that song. And now let me I want to clear while we on songs, because I'm gonna go to my favorite song literally of all time. I mean, across all genres. And we're gonna go to that. But I want to talk about I want to clear the air about Secret Lovers. I always thought, and I'm your nephew and I've been hearing that song forever and ever, amen. I always thought it was about someone cheating. But apparently, when I was at the concert in Florida, when you all played in Florida, you actually told the story of actually what that song, what that song Secret Love is actually about.
Right.
So I want to clear the air just in case people think that you guys were endorsing cheating.
Right.
You weren't endorsing cheating. Right. Tell the people, clear the air about what the actual What Secret Lovers is actually about, that storyline.
Well, sometimes the interviewers get mad at me when I tell them the truth.
Yeah.
Because they don't believe it. But I try to, they think I'm trying to hide, you know. But I wasn't with anybody really at the time when I wrote it, so I wasn't cheating.
Yeah.
So okay. They're like, no, you can't come up with this kind of thing unless you would. But yeah. But when David gave me that track, there was another. It had the mood of innocence and sincerity.
Mm.
And instantly, it came to me about being with somebody you love, but somebody else is prohibiting it.
Mm.
And then I had just seen this movie about with Kirk Douglas, and I forgot the woman's name, when he was young. It was a story about he was an architect, and his wife was just a housewife with big expensive taste. And that wasn't his soulmate. He married her, but they had a marriage where they didn't really have a connection.
Yeah.
And then it was this other woman who was married to a businessman. This blonde woman was married to a businessman. And when they came home, she'd be gazing out the window because he'd come home, sit in his same chair, break out his pipe and his newspaper, and they didn't have a connection. Mm. So she and Kirk Douglas met at the bus stop while they were bringing their kids to put them on the bus every morning.
Okay.
And they didn't have no intention of hooking up, but they just started talking about life, about things. And it turned out that they just fell in love from talking because they both shared the same issues.
Mm.
Plus, she was gorgeous. That helped a lot.
Yeah.
But their falling in love was innocent, but they couldn't really take it anywhere because they were both married.
Yeah.
But I was so deep into that movie because I also was hoping to become a director one day. You know, I loved film, and I used to do school plays and thought I was going to be doing off Broadway and stuff like that. So yeah. I also, acting was another field that I was trying to get into besides music, but that's another movie. But I love movies, and I probably watch so many that they're all mixing up in my head right now. I probably got characters from one movie putting them in another. But that really influenced me to write. And then I started seeing all around me people were having the same problem. And mostly I would see experiences even in school where I know a lot of people fell in love with the wrong person because the girl that might have been rich, father might have been some powerful person. And I've had friends getting threatened that would go, I've heard stories about, I don't mention no names, but I've heard stories, people would go to my friends' houses threatening their mother that if your son sees my daughter again, I'm gonna tell you what's gonna happen.
Wow.
They're gonna be sleeping with the fishes or whatever it might be.
Yeah.
But then that didn't stop them because they were in love. So they had to secretly hide out. And I started seeing so much of this. Then I was seeing married couples even talk about, I hear them talk about their life and stuff where their loved one got away because they married the wrong person, probably from looks or something. And then when they got settled in, they realized that's not who they love. Their soulmate was now, they had a chance to be with and they let it go. And now the person they really love was out there somebody else.
Wow.
So I said, this is what I'm going to write about.
Love that is forbidden for some reason. And them almost going against the odds because their love was stronger than that. Interesting, man.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And when people, you know how it is with that, the sexual attraction, and sometimes not even the sexual attraction, almost like in the case with the Kirk Douglas movie, it wasn't even sex.
Yeah.
It was like, man, you are the bomb person.
Yeah.
And so are you.
Yeah.
And boy, the two of us should be together.
Yeah.
Why didn't we ask God first before we got married for us to meet up?
Because
you're somebody that I need to live the rest of my life with because you understand every ounce of me.
Yeah, yeah.
And I understand everything about you from just us talking to the point where we're touching without even touching.
Wow.
And James Carmichael told me something very important about songwriting. And you know the great James Carmichael, he produced Lionel Richie and he produced all the Motown stuff and he produced everything. He produced us, one of our biggest songs before me and David ended up having the two biggest songs. But he said, let's analyze Marvin Gaye's song, Distant Lover.
That's my joint.
He said, you know, when he talked to Marvin and got into his brain about, you know, songwriting, and he was telling him, you know, a distant lover could be somebody that you love so much but you can't get to, like a lot of people have these jobs where you might be an actor and you might be over in this country doing this, and I have to be over here doing that. We love each other, but it's so hard. You're at a distance and I want you so bad, but I can't get to you.
Yeah.
Or a distant lover, one could be sitting in this chair and one could be sitting right there in the next chair. But because our love is secret, you are so far away.
Wow. Wow.
And I love you so much that I almost don't care who's here. I almost want to touch your hand because I can't take it, your energy. But you're such a distance away from me. Like you. That's why Marvin said, like, 1,000 miles, but you're really just right next to me. And I said, that's what I love about great songwriting.
Yeah.
And nobody's doing that today.
Yeah. Wow. That's deep, though. Because it speaks to someone's innermost thought. Like, you just saying that right now, I'm like, that picture was vivid in my head. And I think that right there is your gift, being able to write something that makes that picture vivid in someone's head.
Mm.
So you're actually in the song. Which brings me to my favorite song, that you penned, and I mean across all genres. I'm talking hip hop, I'm talking R&B, I'm talking country, I'm talking, I mean, I've listened to alternative, I've listened to everything, right? Send From Me is my favorite song.
I didn't actually write that one.
You didn't?
Sam D's.
Really?
Wrote Send For Me, and him and Ron Kersey together wrote Let's Get Closer. We just put our marks on them.
Okay.
And James Carmichael produced them. That's why you have the same sound like we wrote them, like me and David wrote them.
You definitely put your sauce on it, for sure.
Yeah.
Right? For sure. When you first, in that case, when you first heard that song, when they presented it to you, what was your reaction when Send For Me came to you?
You know what? You're going to be surprised. James Carmichael picked that song out especially for me. He came in like this. I was like, well, he's got this special thing for me, a special gift. So I thought, when he opened his arms, it's going to be a Ferrari. You can't get this smirk off your face about this special song you got for me that you had this dude, you picked from his thing just for me.
Yeah.
So when I heard it, I had a blinder over my eyes and over my ears.
What?
Because I had another song that I wanted to do so bad that my mind wouldn't even really let me listen.
Wow.
To that song. So I didn't really want to do it at first.
Really?
Yeah.
What? I told him,
no, I don't want to do that. Even though it sounded pretty good, but my mind was so set on another song that I had written that I wanted to do. And he told me, Brother Wayne, save it. Save what you got. He said, I guess we can't talk about it. He said, so I can only ask you one thing. Can you just trust me? On this, you trusted me for all this other stuff, all the other, hits.
Yeah.
If you just trust me on this, I promise it's gonna be your trademark. I'm like, nah, he's talking trademark.
Now he's talking.
What does this dude think he knows everything? Oh boy, damn! When I finally came to my senses and said, okay, I'll do it. And then when I went in, I remember back in those days, I used to like a little beery now and then. And I think I had a Budweiser or something. I went in there, and all of a sudden, those lyrics made sense to me out of just nowhere, just boom. And then the spirit just took me, or the vibe just took over.
Yeah.
And boom, there it was. And I think they got it in the first take, even though they made me do it a few more times. You always got to do it a few more times. But what he's explaining to me, it was that it's not, your performance on this song doesn't mean like you sing like Luther or Stevie, all over the place, riffing everywhere. But your signature of you were, did something on his record that nobody else is ever going to be able to do. The outcome, the vibe of the outcome, you'll never be able to get this again, and nobody will be able to come after you to try to remake this song.
Not at all.
Even if they sing way better than you,
nobody's
going to be able to create that vibe. And now that's how I knew that this man is the genius that everybody's always said he was. I just wasn't willing to accept it.
Yeah.
I was being stubborn because I had something else that I wanted to do. But when I cleared my mind and started singing, it's almost like you grow up in church and you're singing hymns, and you've been singing these hymns for 30 years.
Yeah.
And then one day when you're going through something in your life, all of a sudden that hymn comes up and every word clicks in now.
Yeah.
You can relate to everything and you start praising God going, Lord, now I see what these old folks are saying.
What they was talking about all along, man.
The whole time. So that's what happens if you open your mind and open your head up and see what's there. you'll see that the lyrics, this song was picked for a reason.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God, this song, this is gonna make me.
Yep.
And it did. Everyone, I remember we were in, and then we got it.
Yeah.
But I was in Chicago at this big cookout. And I remember this lady came up to me and said, I always said, when I met the man that sang this song for yeah. the message in a bottle, because they don't call it symphony, yeah, they always call
right,
it message right. in a bottle.
Message in a bottle.
She said I was going to slap him. And then we was all laughing, and next thing I had was bam.
Oh, she slapped you for real.
She slapped me for real.
Wow.
And everybody said, oh, curse word.
Oh, curse word.
And I looked wow. at her, and then she caught herself and said, oh, I'm so sorry I did that. She said, I lost myself, but wow. I've been holding this in for years.
Wow.
And that's how I knew.
That was it.
That was it.
That was it. Listen, but okay, so just two more things, and we're going to wrap up. One, what is your favorite song that you wrote or that you performed? What's your favorite song out of your catalog?
It's hard to say a favorite. I know when I heard the outcome of when we finished When Love Calls, I was very pleased.
Okay, yeah.
Because Chaka nope. Khan was my girl at the time. And so when I wrote for another girl, a lot of Chaka's influence kept coming through my brain.
Yeah.
And so when it came out, and people were like, I love it, it sounds like y'all, but it's like almost reminiscent of Chaka. Then I knew that I did what
he was supposed
to do.
Yeah.
And then of course, Sin For Me became, as I did it, and I was getting a reaction from it, I was yeah. like, that was my jam.
Yeah.
But one of my all-time favorites was, of course, was Am I Dreaming?
Mmm, yeah. That's yeah. solid.
Yeah.
That's solid. I like it. I mm-hmm. like it. And your favorite place to play? What was your best experience when you got, what was a place that you particularly like to play that you had the best experience?
Well, the one was Hollywood Bowl, like I told you, when the tears came to my eyes, seeing all those thousands of lights light up like fireflies. But I think all the stadiums we played on the Budweiser Superfest, those were my favorite shows, because not only were they my favorite audiences, those super big audiences, but making friends with all the other acts at the time, legendary gotcha. Acts at the time, which is just a beautiful life.
Yeah, yeah.
And then going overseas, playing in Japan, Yokohama. Of course, Tokyo was great, but Tokyo is more of a sterile kind of corporate place. Places like Osaka and Yokohama Bayside Club, those were some wonderful, wonderful, wonderful experiences. And wonderful girls.
Wonderful girls, I love it.
And South Africa,
yeah,
that was, they treated us like the Beatles. And hopefully we're gonna be going back there soon after all these years. But yeah.
I love it. Yeah. Well listen, Unc, appreciate you.
Thank you.
Spending the time
with
me.
Hey, listen.
It was a beautiful thing. And I learned a lot. I thank you. This was a great experience.
Good, man.
You know what I mean?
Good.
So I appreciate you.
Good.
And listen, this has been another episode of the Kre8tive Lounge. I hope and I pray that you got some value out of this, that you learned something, and that you can be inspired by the story. When you put in the work, when you're willing to commit to something, you just never know. And when your calling is calling, you got to answer the phone.
Absolutely.
So thank you all so very much for tapping in. We're going to see you in a minute. Peace. What was the B section? What's the B section?
So the A section is the verses. section is. Blocking out the chords. So I came in and wrote the melody.
Appreciate you, man. Appreciate you. Appreciate you. Yeah, that's dope. That's dope. That's dope.
That's what dope. It is.
And we rap.